be the Holy Trinity, one God, the creator of wind and rain, field and ocean, the bread of life coming down from above, the power at work within us and with the world. Before God and in the company of our sisters and brothers, let us confess our sins. God and Father of all,
we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed. We have thought better of ourselves than others. We have told lies, said hurtful things, acted in ways we wish we could take back, and looked the other way when action was needed. In your mercy, O God, forgive us, cleanse us, and heal us. For the sake of Jesus, our Savior. Amen.
And now hear the good news. God, who loves you dearly, forgives you all your sin, raises you to new life in Jesus Christ, and renews you by the power of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Thank you.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God, our teacher and guide, you draw us to yourself and welcome us as beloved children. Help us to lay aside all envy and selfish ambition, that we may walk in your ways of wisdom and understanding as servants of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
Sometimes we mistakenly think that the job of a prophet, or a pastor for that matter, is a soft one. Not so, says Jeremiah. After announcing God's word of judgment against God's people, he discovers an assassination plot against him. Because they did not like the Lord's message, they were prepared to kill God's messenger. How did he respond? He continues to trust in God even while being severely tested. A reading from Jeremiah. It was the Lord who made it known to me, and I knew. Then he showed me their evil deeds, but I was like a gentle lamb led to the slaughter. And I did not know it was against me that they devised schemes, saying, let us destroy the tree with its fruit. Let us cut him off from the land of the living, so that his name will no longer be remembered. But you, O Lord of hosts, who judge righteously, who try the heart and the mind, let me see your retribution upon them, for to you I have committed my cause. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Do you want to be counted wise? Then listen up to a reading from James. I've chosen to read from the message, which is quite different from the one in front of you, so you may wish to lay that aside. Do you want to be counted wise? Then here's what you do. Live wisely, live humbly. It's the way you live, not the way you talk. Mean-spirited ambition isn't wisdom. Boasting that you are wise isn't wisdom. Twisting the truth to make yourself sound wise isn't wisdom either. It's the furthest thing from wisdom. Whenever you try to look better than others or get the better of others, things fall apart and everyone ends up at each other's throats. Real wisdom, God's wisdom, begins with a holy life. It is gentle and reasonable, overflowing with mercy and blessings. That will develop a healthy, robust community that not only lives right with God, but also treats each other with dignity and honor. Where do you think all these appalling wars and all this violence come from? Do you think they just happen? They come about because you want your own way. You lust for what you don't have and are willing to kill to get it. You're like spoiled children, each wanting. So let God work his will in you. Yell aloud no to the devil and watch him scamper away. Then say a quiet yes to God, and he will be there in no time. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
He did not want anyone to know it, for he was teaching his disciples, saying to them, "The Son of Man is to be betrayed into human hands, and they will kill him, and 3 days after being killed, he will rise again." But they did not understand what he was saying, and were afraid to ask him. Then they came to Capernaum, and when he was in the house, he asked them, "What were you arguing about on the way?" But they were silent, for on the way they had argued with one another who was the greatest. He sat down, called the 12, and said to them, "Whoever wants to be first must be last of all and servant of all." Then he took a little child and put it among them, and taking it in his arms, he said to them, "Whoever welcomes one such child in my name welcomes me, and whoever welcomes me welcomes not me, but the one who sent me." The Gospel of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
I would like to invite any kids here up to the front for the children's message. Thank you for the reminder of welcoming children in our midst and welcoming everybody else. Help us to take that welcome that you share with us inside these doors and remember that we can bring that outside as well. In your holy name we pray. Amen. All right, go ahead.
He was often almost moved to tears.
tears most days in class when he was teaching about subjects that he loved. And we students, who really had no say over what the grown-ups were doing at that time, loved him, and his hockey players loved him. In reality, it was that he cared so much that he put his whole self into anything he did, which meant holding his students and his team and the parents to a high standard and expecting results. I remember, though, one of my good friends, if you'll indulge me just a little story, one of my good friends at Kennedy for American History our senior year, and despite what he was well aware of about Kennedy's standards, he decided he was just going to screw around the whole year anyway. So no big surprise, he flunked the class and was informed by the office that he was going to have to do summer school in order to get his diploma on that last day. So after getting this notice, the kid decided to walk by Mr. Kennedy's classroom and flip the bird, thinking Kennedy wasn't in there and he wouldn't see. Out popped Kennedy's head. "I suppose that was for me," he yelled out the door. "Get in here." And so my friend slunk in, fearing for his life because he figured he was going to get yelled at or pounded on or worse. He'd heard the stories. And Mr. Kennedy, in a firm but calm way, talked to him for a while, explaining that, yes, he'd flunked him because he didn't do anything, and he knew that this kid was better than that and how he needed to do better, because he also knew this kid did not have an easy time at home, and he was going to help him pass. And lo and behold, the kid did the summer school and passed, and was a fan of Kennedy's ever since. That was Mr. Kennedy. But the parts of him that instilled fear, and the assumptions that kind of went along with them, and the rumors and those things, really blinded people to what was happening. And so as these things go, they just got rid of him and hoped he'd go away. But then this is what fear does. It creates in us that desire to put aside and put away those things that we think we're afraid of. Now, when fear is warranted, which it very much sometimes is, like when there is a real threat that's coming at us, then, well, this all seems to make sense. But when fear kind of becomes that lens through which we see the world, when it becomes our default due to those things that have built up in and around us, and that could be things like rumor or misinformation, could be something like the 24-hour news that we seem to see all the time on repeat that really seeks to seeks ratings by playing on our fears, by highlighting and sensationalizing and blowing up all kinds of little minute details, well then it starts to look like nothing makes sense. Fear is actually one of the most debilitating things that we face in our lives. It has the power to freeze us and creates in us so much that's irrational and so much that is just debilitating. It stops us from taking risks, from seeing situations clearly, and it really can be something that blocks us from having faith. And when fear trumps faith, well, then we find ourselves doing and saying and thinking all kinds of things that are counter to who we are and who we have been created to be. We stop asking questions. We start going it alone, trying to grab our slice. We begin to make life all about us and our survival. We shut off and shut out community. Everything around us is a threat, and so we refuse to forgive, and we start to see people not for their humanity, but as the thing that we're afraid of. We start maybe mind reading and assuming and on and on. There's a whole bunch of world conditions, wars, refugee crisis, all kinds of global suffering, that if we dig down, it is not too long until we hit a common root, and that root is fear. And we begin maybe to realize the damage that fear can bring, and even more so, as one of my favorite novelists, Marilynne Robinson, aptly states, that fear is not a Christian habit of mind. As people of faith, we say over and over again in our prayers, we read in our sacred texts, the Bible, that the counter to fear is faith. Faith calls us to things that fear pulls us from. Faith asks us to step out in love and compassion, even when fear might tell us to do differently. Faith calls us to share our hearts, take risks, invite the stranger, welcome children, and the ones who we try to push away from ourselves. This kind of faith, counter to what may be trying to convince us otherwise, is not some kind of pipe dream, and it's not something that is impossible. It's not some flowery thing that we put on a greeting card or a pithy saying we toss about or on Facebook or in our mass emails. This kind of faith asks for our courage, our strength, our tenacity to walk wonder if the disciples hadn't been afraid to ask the question of Jesus about what was going on, what that walk to Capernaum might have been like. What might they have asked about God, about themselves as disciples, about their place in all of this? Would their first concern have been who was the greatest? What might have been different? Now, of course, we can't know that. But the striking thing is that they had the stuff of faith in front of them all along, and yet so often they chose instead the way of fear. Jesus is a counter to fear in the world. He constantly is walking with his disciples and asking them to confront their fears, encouraging them, do not be afraid, asking them, why are you afraid, and telling them, have faith. But again, not the kind of faith you try to talk yourself into or try to rationalize, because a faith that counters fear is not some kind of intellectual exercise. It is something that we feel in our gut, and it is there with us because of Jesus, who showed up and changed the playing field. What is thought to bring security and certainty, such as keeping others away, amassing great power, shutting out the least, stamping down your enemies, Jesus shows as actually being what contributes to more fear, and instead invites disciples into a life abundant through love, through vulnerability, through care, and through a strong challenge to the powers that hold everyone to a standard that no one is able to live up to or live into. And so very simply this morning, disciples, I'm going to ask you, ask us all, to take a moment and think about, what are you afraid of? What are we afraid of? What fear is living in your heart in this moment? What is keeping you from leaning into faith, into asking the questions, into from hearing the truth? What in your heart is driving a wedge between you and someone else, or you and a group of someone else's, because of fear? What is it? Take a moment in the silence of this moment, and find that thing, and hold it, just for a moment. Know that whatever that is, that Jesus is with you, that Jesus is with us in it, walking with us in whatever stands in the way, helping us to welcome all in his name, and know that through Jesus, we can move beyond our fears. In Jesus' name.
Thank you.
believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Gathered by the Holy Spirit and fed by the Word of God, we come together as the baptized children of God to pray for the whole church, all the world, and all those in need. Gracious God, we pray for the church in its many expressions. Give it the gift of discernment to know what is needed, and the humility to ask for what is necessary. Lord, in your mercy. We give thanks for another year of harvests, for farmers and gardeners, farmers markets and community gardens, including our own. Teach us to share the earth's abundance with all who hunger. Lord, in your mercy. We pray for those who struggle with envy, and for those who suffer from impulses that are at war within them, especially those addicted to drugs of many kinds. We pray for those in any kind of need, especially those now named.
We pray for those who mourn. We pray for Gail First and her family as they mourn the loss of Steve, who died last Wednesday. We pray for Dick Calvert and his family as they mourn the loss of his sister Nancy. And we pray for Carla and John Bryant as they mourn the loss of their son Richard, who died early this morning. Hold them in your loving arms and surround them with your comfort, O God. We also pray for all of those listed in our bulletin and those who we now meet.
We pray for Karen Ty, who was recently notified that her daughter, Kim Tylen Carlson, has inoperable cancer. Lord, in your mercy.
Lord, grant us the serenity to accept the things we cannot change, the courage to change the things we can, and the wisdom to know the difference. Lord, in your mercy. We pray for those in the West who have lost their homes by fire, more than 1,000 now, and those in the Middle East who have fled their homes because of civil war. May those who have lost their homes through fire find the help they need to rebuild. And may the flood of refugees find a welcome mat out in their new homes, including our own. Lord, in your mercy. As Pope Francis prepares to visit these United States, keep him out of harm's way, as you did the prophet Jeremiah. And bless his challenging messages to all Christians, including us. Lord, in your mercy. We pray for the children in our congregation and in our community. Give them compassionate families, meaningful mentors, sensitive teachers, faithful friends. Assure them that Jesus is always with them, loves them forever. Lord, in your mercy.
But what else do God's people say?
Pray for healing for Jim Martin.
Lord, in your mercy.
We give thanks for the saints and all those who have seasoned our lives of faith by theirs. Preserve us in faith until we join them in your eternal kingdom. Lord, in your mercy.
Into your God, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your abundant mercy through Jesus Christ, our Savior.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Let us share signs of peace with one another.
Thank you.
Remembering, therefore, his life-giving death and glorious resurrection, we await your promised life for all this dying world. Breathe your spirit on us and on this bread and cup. Carry us into your arms from death to life, that we may live as your chosen ones, clothed in the righteousness of Christ.
Amen.
And so in confidence we pray.
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Jesus said, whoever comes to me will never be hungry. Whoever believes in me will never be thirsty. All are welcome at our Lord's table. Stand as you're able. May the grace of our Lord Christ and the gifts of his body and blood strengthen, keep, and unite us, now and forever.
Amen. Glorious God of life, at this table we have tasted your promised future, in which there will be no more death or pain. Strengthen us to be your body in the world, that your praise and glory may resound in all creation. Through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
And now receive the benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you.